So, you want to buy a graphics card, but you're not able because 1. They are so expensive, or 2. You cannot afford one, but you want to see what's new coming out from AMD or Nvidia next year. So, while waiting it out, why don't you try one of these new onboard graphics? Intel UHD 770 from 12600K, Intel UHD 750 from 11900K, and Vega 8 from AMD Ryzen 5700G. Let's see which one of these three come up tops. Hey guys, welcome and welcome back to my channel, RealMelTan. Now, let's first take a look at the benchmarks. First game, CSGO. On 1080p low settings, the UHD 770 scores an average of 98.9fps, and the UHD 750 scores 56fps. Oh yes, we also threw in a GT 710 to see how it compares against modern integrated graphics. The GT 710 scores only 42.6fps, however. On the Vega 8, on the other hand, powers through with 159fps, even managing to do 77fps on 1440p. Game number 2, Rainbow Six Siege. On the blue side, UHD 770 comes up tops at 48fps, with UHD 70 trailing slightly behind at 43. The GT 710 struggles to play at 19fps. Red Team wins again with a much more playable 94fps for an esports title, 2 times the performance compared to Intel graphics. Esports games tend to love CPUs or APUs with high IPCs, which traditionally meant Intel. But AMD has proven her worth here, winning both Rainbow Six Siege and CSGO. We did not test this game using DirectX, but since Vulkan is a faster API, make sure to use Vulkan if you plan to use Intel onboard graphics. Next, game number 3, Final Fantasy XIV Endwalker. A highly popular MMO, Endwalker is the latest addition to the game, and its graphical requirements are much more demanding than before. At 1080p standard desktop performance, the UHD 770 is capable of running the game with a score of 5947, with the UHD 750 trailing behind with a score of little over 4000. If you have the GT 710, you'll find it hard to play as it only manages to do almost 2400. The Vega 8 performs slightly better than the rest with a score of 5746. And finally, our only AAA title, GTA 5. Yes, like our previous test, you can play GTA 5 with built-in graphics. Once again, UHD 770 does slightly better than UHD 750 with 32 and 42 respectively. The GT 710 struggles with 26fps. On the other hand, gamers can do better with Vega 8 with a more respectable 72fps. So, you may be wondering, what are we testing this graphics with? The 12600K sits on the MSI Z690 Tomahawk WIFI D4, 11900K on the MSI Z590 Tomahawk WIFI, and the 5700G on the Gigabyte B550i AORUS Pro AX. All of these sets share a pair of 16GB G.Skill Flare X and are powered by the Fractal Design ION Plus 760P for Intel and the Seasonic Prime GX1300 for AMD. So, if you want to use this onboard graphics, make sure to do this. 1. If the Intel iGPU is off, make sure to turn it on in the BIOS and install the relevant driver. Number 2, do set the VRAM of the Vega 8 graphics to 2GB to enjoy the maximum gaming potential. If you do not see the Vega 8 graphics appearing when you install the GPU, make sure to install Radeon software drivers. Yes, you can play most of these games using onboard graphics. But of course, you have to manage your expectations. You gotta play the games at 1080p low or even 720p if you want more FPS. We can see that Intel onboard graphics has come a long way since I don't know the names of these previous UHDs. The Intel UHD 770 on 12600K is a slight improvement over the UHD 750. You can play your esports titles such as CSGO or Rainbow Six Siege, but I'm not sure if you want to do so. I mean, CSGO is still not a problem, but Rainbow Six Siege? With less than 60fps on both onboard graphics in a game where every FPS counts, would you do so? Let me know in the comments below. As for the GT 710, it had its glory days, but it loses out to all 3 onboard graphics. It may not be your first choice when you are buying graphics, but don't just count it out yet. Having 4 HDMI ports is quite a rarity these days, and it will be useful if you need more than one HDMI port. So, if I have to choose, which one would I go for? 5700G! Why? Number 1, the 5700G uses Vega 8 Vega graphics, a more junior common version of Radeon graphics. You can be sure when you turn on your games, especially the AAA titles, that you will not run into any issues when you try to boot up the game. Intel graphics, on the other hand, may run into some issues, especially for the older titles, because these games tend to recognize AMD or Nvidia graphics, but Intel, I don't know, maybe Intel, they don't recognize it and it just shut it off. Number 2, I'm able to allocate up to 2GB of VRAM for the Vega 8. For the UHD 770, only up to 160MB. Having a higher amount of VRAM ensures that you have a much more smoother gaming experience. That's almost 20 times difference between the Vega 8 and the UHD 770. And of course, the Vega 8 can make use of AMD FreeSync technology. If you're getting an FPS of, for example, 75, you can get a 1080p monitor that can make use of FreeSync. AMD FreeSync here helps to vary the refresh rate of your monitor while you play your game. No more screen tearing, and that's definitely a plus. On the other hand, there's no such thing as AMD FreeSync or NVIDIA G-Sync on Intel onboard graphics. Of course, it'll still be a very long time before onboard graphics can reach the performance of discrete graphics. But if you're still on a hunt for a discrete GPU, you can consider using one of these onboard graphics, especially the Vega 8. So, if you like this comparison, make sure to smash the thumbs up button. And in the meantime, do check out the review of my Intel UHD 750 versus Vega 7 video. And make sure to also smash the subscribe button because we're going to do more 12th Gen Elder Lake videos. So, I hope to see you next episode. And with that, goodbye.